So today I'm going to talk with you about some of the research that I've done at Carnegie Mellon, as well as some of the work that I've been doing at the FTC. At CMU, I run a lab called the SciLab Usable Privacy and Security Laboratory. And this picture is from a couple of years ago, but you can see we have lots of students and faculty who are involved in this interdisciplinary lab, where our focus is on the human side of security and privacy. Right now, I'm at the Federal Trade Commission, serving as the Chief Technologist, working for the chairwoman of the FTC. It's been a lot of fun, and I'll try to give you a few highlights of some of the things I've been doing there. But of course, the standard disclaimer, these views are my own. I don't speak for anyone, let alone the FTC. Okay, so for those of you who are sort of wondering, what is this FTC thing? So it is an independent law enforcement agency of the federal government. The FTC has about 1,100 people on their staff. The vast majority of them are lawyers. So that's been kind of interesting, being surrounded by attorneys all day. Most of these lawyers sit in one of the two FTC buildings in Washington, D.C., but we also have seven regional offices that are very small that are throughout the country. The structure of the FTC is we have five commissioners who are selected by the president. They're confirmed by the Senate. Currently, we actually only have three commissioners because two resigned, and I guess the Senate has other things to do instead of replacing our commissioners. So we have three wonderful commissioners, and a really interesting fact is they're all women, as are most of the leadership of the FTC right now, which for me makes it a really fun and very, very different sort of place to be working. The mission of the FTC is consumer protection and competition. So on the competition side, we review mergers and acquisitions. But on the consumer protection side, we do a wide range of things to protect consumers. We look at companies that have unfair and deceptive practices. We look at scams, fraud, and a lot of privacy and security cases right now. As I said, the FTC is mostly lawyers. We also have an economics group, which are PhD economists. And then we have this little itty-bitty Office of Technology Research and Investigation, which actually just got started less than 2 years ago, but despite its small size, is doing great things and hires summer interns. So for those of you who are students or are faculty who have students, definitely keep an eye out for the notice that they'll be looking for summer interns for next summer. So I work closely with this office. It's called OTEC, although I actually work out of the chairwoman's office myself, which is an interesting position to be in the organization and allows me to work with people throughout the whole agency. All right, so I had a lot of things I wanted to talk about today, and I really couldn't decide. So I'm going to give you basically five vignettes, which sort of are related, so bear with me on that. So we're going to talk about why usable privacy and security studies are important. We're going to talk about one of the big problems with doing these studies, which is that you need to study users under a risky situation, but you can't actually hurt your users in these studies. We're going to talk about password changes. We're going to talk about a form of identity theft related to mobile phone hijacking, which is something I knew nothing about until it happened to me. And then we're going to talk about how the FTC protects consumers and how you may be able to help us. Okay, so let's start with why should we do usable privacy and security studies? Well, the first reason is because we have a lot of really bad and unusable privacy and security that we need to do something about. So we have all these password interfaces that are very complicated, and they just tell us that our password is weak and we need to do better without giving us any useful feedback about how to do that. We have all sorts of security dialogues, like the one that popped up at the beginning of my presentation or the one here, and you'll see a few more. And for most users, they see them, they don't know what they mean, they swat them away. They're not actually informing users or helping them make better security decisions. So how can user studies help with this? So there's four main areas where I think user studies can be helpful in the security and privacy space. So the first is to help us assess needs. So at the beginning of a project, we're trying to figure out what is it should we build. And if we're looking at the human side of things, we want to actually go talk to humans and find out what it is they think they need. We can also use user studies to examine trade-offs. So we may have a number of different possible features that we can offer, a number of different possible strategies or approaches. Which is going to be better for our users? Let's do a user study and find out. We can do a user study to evaluate. So if we have a prototype system or an existing system that's all the way built, we can run a user study to evaluate whether the system actually meets the requirements that we have and in what ways it might need to be improved. And finally, we can find root causes. So we know we have a system that's problematic, users are complaining, people aren't doing the right thing, and we want to understand why. And so a user study can help us identify what exactly is going wrong here. Why are users not understanding what it is they're supposed to do? Now, there are a lot of excuses for not doing usability studies. I talk to a lot of people who are not usability experts, and they say, well, it's really nice that you do these user studies, but I'm not going to do them. Okay, well, why not? Well, you know, if people weren't so lazy or stupid or careless, my system would work just fine. The problem is not my system. The problem is the users. I don't need to study them to find that out. I'm a cryptographer. I'm not a usability expert. Okay, that's a really valid excuse for why you shouldn't do a user study. But you should find somebody who knows about usability, and you should work with them to do a user study. I think it's really important that we have cryptographers and technical security people raising their hand and saying, okay, well, I can't do this, but I know it needs to be done, and my organization needs to find the resources to make sure that these user studies actually happen. I already know what people want. No need to ask them. I know. No time, no money. All right, very common problem. Projects are often running late. They're over budget. And user studies are viewed as a really expensive thing, which is only going to put the project more over budget and more behind schedule. And certainly, you can do a really elaborate user study, which will cost a lot of money and will take a lot of time. But there are a lot of budget or economy user study techniques that can offer a lot of insights, even if they don't take a lot of time or money. And often, it's better doing a very short and inexpensive study than doing no study. I find the system easy to use, so it must be usable. I created it. It works for me. Nobody else needs to be able to use it, right? And then my favorite, my kids can use the system, so it definitely must be usable. That's a picture of my son when he was two. He's 15 now. As you can see, he started using computers at an early age. There are a lot of adults who did not start using computers when they were two. And so the fact that my son can use the system is not really a good benchmark for whether anybody else can use it. But I hear this all the time, and I have actually seen published papers at very good conferences where people cite as evidence the fact that their kids can use their system. Okay, so as I mentioned in my introduction, one of the problems we have when actually running usable security studies is that secure systems, the whole point here is that the system is secure when it's under attack. And so if we want to test the usability, often we need to test the usability under attack conditions. But the problem is that we're not allowed to hurt people when we do user studies. So we need to find a way of making people feel and behave as they would in a risky situation without actually putting them at risk. So how do we do this? I'm going to show you a few examples of some studies that my students have done over the years where they've had what I think are some nice solutions to this problem. So back in 2007, we did a study. Serge Egelman was a student back then, and this was actually his work. We did a study looking at the phishing warnings that the web browsers at the time, back in 2007, had when they detected that you clicked on a link that they thought was a phishing attack. So the challenge here is that we wanted to observe people when those warnings popped up in their web browser, but we didn't want them to know that that's what we were interested in. You know, if we told them that, they would see the warning and they'd be like, ah, that's what they're studying. What should I do, right? So we wanted them to behave naturally. And we also, when there was a phishing attack that they encountered, we wanted them to feel like this was a real attack and that they should take it seriously and not feel like, oh, I'm in a study, nobody's gonna hurt me. Right, so how do we do this? Well, it required a little bit of deception. We framed our study as a lab study on online shopping, and that's what we told participants. You're coming to our lab to do a study on online shopping. And the first thing we had them do was to go to Amazon and purchase a box of paper clips. Mostly because those are cheap, so we could afford to reimburse them for paper clips. And then after they made that purchase, we gave them a survey about their shopping experience on Amazon. This was actually a survey that was developed by people in our business school for another study that really was about online shopping. While they were taking that survey, that's when we phished them. And we sent them an email that looked like it came from Amazon. And then after they finished the survey, we asked them to check their email and get the receipt for the paperclip so that we could reimburse them. And then they would see the email that we sent them, only they thought that Amazon sent it, and they would click on it because it urged them to do something very quickly. And they fell for the phish. So this is the email that we sent them from Amazon. You can see it says your Amazon.com order, your approval required. And the key thing that they saw was, please approve this delay so that we can continue processing your order. If we haven't received your approval by the end of the business tomorrow, the item will be canceled. So this is the call for urgent action. Almost everybody clicked on the link underneath it. And we didn't do anything tricky with the link. You can see this is exactly the link they saw. This is exactly where it takes them, amazonaccounts.net. Almost everybody fell for it. And when they fell for it, then in the web browser they were using, they would get this pop-up saying this might be a phishing attack. Right? And that's what we wanted to study, is what would they do at that point? And we were testing three different browsers, and we did actually get significantly different results depending on which warning they saw. Some of the warnings were a lot better than others. So that was interesting in and of itself. But what was also interesting was that we did this in our lab, and so we watched the whole thing. And we had the opportunity to ask the participants questions afterwards. And so some of the things that we observed them doing and that they talked about gave us some really good insights into the root causes for why people were ignoring some of these phishing warnings. So just a few examples. We learned that people were really confused by domain names. So we actually had a participant look at that URL and say, the address in the browser was of amazonaccounts.net, which is a genuine address. Right? This person didn't realize that that was different from amazon.com, even though they read that URL. And we saw that repeatedly and learned that most non-experts really know nothing about how to parse URLs. And if you want to teach them something about this, that's an area that you need to focus on. We also realized that people had very confused mental models that were nothing like the mental models that we as experts had. So for example, we had people who would click on the link in the email, browser would pop up, they'd see the warning, they'd close the web browser. They went back to their email, click on the link again, warning would pop up, they'd close the web browser. And they'd just do this over and over and over again. And so we asked them, why are you doing this? What are you thinking? And they said, well, there seems to be some problem with the web browser or the web, and so usually when there's a problem, you just keep clicking on it, and eventually the problem will go away. Right? So that was their mental model. They had no idea that there was a problem related to something in the email, because the warning wasn't in the email, and the warning wasn't in their email client. The warning was in the web browser, and so they were not making that connection, which in hindsight makes perfect sense, but that was something that we would not have thought of had we not done this user study. The results of this research, we came up with some recommendations, and I'm pleased to say that actually some of the web browser vendors actually incorporated many of our suggestions into later versions of their phishing warnings. Okay, around that same time, a little bit later, we did a study on SSL certificate warnings and the problems people had there. As you can see, the warnings at the time had lots of text on them and nobody read them, and most people just wanted to get rid of them and move on with visiting this site that they were being warned about. So we wanted to study what was happening, design a better warning, and in particular, when we say better in this case, it's not that we want people to just stop visiting websites. Often, when an SSL certificate warning pops up, there's actually no danger. It's actually a website that's really fine to visit, but it has a self-signed certificate or something like that. And so we want people to be able to distinguish between the cases when they really need to heed the warning and the cases where it's okay to get on with doing their work. And so if you look at the physical world of warnings, let me show you an analogy to the problem. So there's some warnings in the physical world are about things that are always dangerous. You don't need to make a decision here. It is always dangerous to put your baby in a coffee maker. There's never a circumstance when you should do that, okay? It is always dangerous to drink poison, and it is always dangerous to go walking around in mines that are hazardous. Like, you should never do any of these things. However, there are some things that are context dependent. So drinking wine is sometimes dangerous. For example, if you are driving a car, then drinking wine is dangerous. If you are pregnant, then drinking wine is dangerous. And it is up to you, the user of the wine, to make that determination as to whether you are in a risky context or whether you're in a safe context when you decide whether or not to drink that wine. So computer security dialogues often are also context dependent, and they tend to be more like wine than like poison. You need to make the decision as to whether you're in a risky context or not. Now, it would be really nice if software developers would help users do this. And the problem with a lot of warnings is that they don't help the users. And we would like to see warning dialogues that actually give the users some information to help them figure out whether they are in a risky context or in a safe context. So when we do user studies on warnings, we also need to test the warnings in both types of contexts to see if they are successful in both cases. All right, so here's an example of a warning in two different contexts. One is risky and one is not. And those of you who are sitting close enough to the screen to actually see it, I see some nodding heads. Some of you have probably spotted which one is suspicious and which one is benign. And what we've learned from talking to experts is that when experts look at these warnings, they look immediately at that line that says publisher, and in bold, it has the name of the publisher. And if the publisher is a misspelled, you know, Microsoft Corporation, they get very suspicious right away. It does not take them a lot of analysis. You know, they spot that right away. But what we've also seen is that when we talk to non-experts, they can stare at that for a long time and not notice that there's something suspicious going on. So we said, well, how is it that we could get people to pay attention to that suspicious information? How can we get those non-experts to have their eyes jump there the way that experts do and have them notice this and respond appropriately? So we thought of a bunch of different ideas and decided to do a user study to see whether any of them would actually work. So here's one example. I'm only going to show you a few of the many, many examples that we tried. So one idea was, well, let's do what warning signs do. There's a ANSI standard for warning signs. They have to be in these really garish black, yellow, and red colors. It looks terrible on this warning, but you know, it should pop out, get people's attention. We could also add some animation. Apparently, my animation is not working. All right, there was animation there. Here's another version, which again, the animation is not working. But we had the name of the publisher slowly fade into the screen to try to attract your attention. This one, again, it's not showing, but the idea was that if you wanted to install this risky software, you actually had to take your mouse and drag it across the name of the publisher, right? And until you dragged your mouse across the name of that publisher, it wasn't going to let you actually install this risky software. And then the final one, and this one I was very excited about. So, you know, I, as a professor, I try to get students to read things all the time, and often they don't. And even the threat of a test sometimes doesn't get them to read what they're supposed to read. But one thing that I think will usually get people to read what they're supposed to read is if they have to retype it. Right? It's really hard to type something without reading it. I think it can be done, but it's hard. And so we thought, well, what if we have them retype that critical information? Then perhaps they will actually read it. So we tried that. And so we wanted to see whether any of these and a bunch of other ideas that we had would actually work. And we also wanted to know, when you see a benign situation, how much does it slow you down? We wanted to make sure that, yeah, it's going to slow you down a little bit, but we didn't want it to be super annoying or people wouldn't want to use this. So we had lots of different conditions. We needed to be able to test this on lots of people. And it was too many people to actually bring into our lab like we'd done in the phishing study. We also needed to make sure that we could, if we did it not in our lab, we need to be able to remotely observe the participants. And we needed to make sure that they felt that this was really real and were behaving the way they would in a real situation. But once again, we couldn't actually hurt them. We couldn't actually put them at risk. So we used Amazon Mechanical Turk for this study. For those of you who are not familiar, this is a service provided by Amazon.com where you can post surveys or short jobs that you're willing to pay people 10 cents or a dollar or a few dollars to do. They come to Amazon, they sign up for your task, they do it online, you pay Amazon one big lump sum payment, and Amazon then hands out a dollar to each person who did your study. So it's a very convenient system for this sort of research. So we posted a study that we said was an online games evaluation survey. We said it was from Carnegie Mellon. They had the usual Carnegie Mellon informed consent form. At the beginning of the study, we told them, you know, we're going to assign you three games to evaluate. We assigned them the first game, the Mars Buggy Online. We told them that this game was not our game. It was out there on the web. We had no responsibility for it, but we wanted them to go play it and evaluate it. So they would go to the website, they'd play the game, they'd come back, and they had our survey. And the first thing we asked them on the survey was whether they were able to play the game. And this is really important. We wanted them to see that if they couldn't play the game, that they could still get paid in the study. We would just give them a different game to play. Then we asked them lots of questions about the game. And you know, was it fun? Have you ever played it before? Then we assigned them another game. Second one was the Tom and Jerry refrigerator game. Went through the same process. Then we got through the third game. And when we got to the third game, they were told that they needed to install the latest version of Microsoft Silverlight in order to play the game. And a warning popped up. Right? Here we had people divided into, I don't know, like 20 different conditions. And they all saw different warnings depending on which condition they were in. Half of them saw warnings that were benign, as in the case here. And half of them saw suspicious warnings, as in this case. But they all saw different warnings. Some of them had the animation. Some of them had delays. Some of them forced them to retype things. They all had different warnings. And really, we didn't care what they thought about the games. Really, we were interested in, did they choose to go ahead and install the software? And in reality, they were not installing the software. We just made it look like they were. Or did they cancel and go back and say, give me a different game to evaluate? Okay, so the results were interesting. We had over 2,000 people come to our website, play these games. We found that in the benign scenario, for the most part, people actually did go ahead and install the software, although some of the approaches slowed people down quite a bit. In the suspicious scenario, some of the warnings were effective and some of them were really completely ineffective. And we found that having people retype things was actually one of the more effective ones. The swipe one was also effective, and introducing a delay also appeared to be effective. But what we wondered was, people saw this exactly once, and there was some novelty. I've never seen this kind of crazy warning before. What if they saw it all the time? Would they still behave the same way? So we decided to do some more experiments. And we did an experiment, which I don't have time to get into, but it involved actually dismissing the warning over and over and over again and trying to see if they noticed when the warning changed and gave them different information. Showing you what happened here, with some of our warnings, including our control and that garish-looking antsy one, at the beginning, if people only saw it once, they actually complied with it about 50% of the time, which is not great, but it's better than what happened after they saw it 100 times when they only complied with it 10% of the time. So over time, the warning, which starts out not very effective, gets even less effective. Then we had a bunch of warnings, including those that had the animation and the delays. They started out at about 80% effectiveness, but once you've seen them 100 times, they're now down to about 50% effectiveness. What we found was that the type and swipe warnings actually didn't degrade. You know, they started out 60, 70% effective, and they stayed there. And that was really interesting. And without actually having run the study, we would not have been able to determine that some of these warnings, which seemed good on the first attempt, after 100 presentations, were no longer as effective. And we really needed to actually run the study in order to distinguish between them. Okay, so now we're going to stop and change gears, and we're going to talk about passwords. Okay, so shortly after I arrived at the FTC, I saw that the FTC was tweeting about passwords. Now, the FTC actually tweets a lot. We have people who tweet, they blog, they make cute little videos that they want you to share with all your friends. A lot of actually really good consumer education related to security and privacy. So if you haven't seen it, check it out and share it with your non-technically sophisticated friends. But on this particular day, they were tweeting about passwords, and they were telling people that they should all go change their passwords. And this struck me as not really the best advice to be giving people. And this is not unusual to have this sort of advice. You probably all have seen advice like this: passwords are like underpants, and you should change them often. I actually think this is terrible advice. I don't think passwords are anything like underpants. And you certainly, as far as passwords go, you don't need to go around changing your passwords every day, which hopefully you are doing with your underpants. So I went and talked to the powers that be about this, and people pointed out that at the FTC, where I have 6 different passwords for different systems, I have to change them every 60 days. And I went and talked to the system administrators and said, why is this? And I talked to them about some of the research that suggests that this may not be the best thing for us to do in order to have secure systems. They were very interested. They asked to see copies of the research. And I wrote up a little memo for them where I explained this argument. And then I decided, hey, I'm going to blog about this. One of the really cool things of being the chief technologist of the FTC is I get to blog on the front page of the FTC website, and lots of people read it. So I wrote this blog post, "Time to Rethink Mandatory Password Changes," and it got a lot of attention and a lot of people emailing it to their system administrators. There were a bunch of news reports about it as well. So let me kind of walk you through the basic argument here. So why is it that people think it's a good idea to have people change their passwords every 60 days or 30 days or 90 days in the first place? Well, I think the theory here is that we may have attackers who have compromised some of our users' passwords. They're in our system, but we don't know it. Or at least we don't know who they are. We don't know which accounts have been compromised. So if we force all of our users to change their passwords every 60 days, then every 60 days we're flushing all of these attackers out of our system. At least that's the theory. Now, the problem is that when we force our users to change their passwords every 60 days, users tend to do something fairly predictable, which is to transform their passwords in predictable ways. Their new password has a lot of similarity to their old password. So they may do things like take lowercase letters and just capitalize them, or take whatever the last digit in their password is, and instead of ending in 1, it now ends in 11. Or instead of ending in 1, it ends in 2. Or instead of ending in 1, it ends in 12. Or instead of ending in 1, this user is very clever. They use 1 with a shift key. Now it's an exclamation point. Or maybe they just append the date that you made them change their password to the end of the password. I've heard that's very common. Researchers at University of North Carolina did a study. So UNC required their users to change their passwords every 3 months. And these UNC researchers were able to get the hashed passwords from defunct accounts, so students who'd graduated and whatnot. And they were able to get a whole bunch of hashed passwords for each one of these defunct accounts. And they ran it through a cracking system. They let it run for a while. They cracked lots of these passwords. And they took a data set of about 7,700 accounts for which they had at least one cracked password that was not the last password in the sequence. And then what they did is they fed this into their system, all of the not last passwords that they'd cracked, and said, OK, we know this password. Can we guess the next password that we haven't yet cracked? So they had an algorithm that used those transformations that I showed you, and they attempted to guess all of the passwords, the next passwords, based on the last password. How did they do? Well, in simulating an online attack where you have less than 5 guesses, they were actually able to guess correctly 17% of the passwords in less than 5 guesses, which I think is pretty amazing. When they went for an offline attack, they gave themselves 3 seconds with whatever compute power they had, and they were able to crack 41% of the accounts. So this shows you that a lot of users are doing very predictable things, that they can be cracked. Just if you know their last password, then you know their next password. So this forcing users to change their password, in this case every 90 days, is not really buying you security here. There's another paper from folks at Carleton, which does some theoretical analysis and comes up with the conclusion that password expiry may help a little bit in preventing a brute force attack, but if you just use a slow hash function, that's going to help a lot more with a lot less pain for the users. They also point out that if you have an attacker in the system that you don't know about, that attacker may have installed keyloggers, and so even if the user changes their password and the attacker can't guess it, well, they'll just sniff it out. There's a number of surveys that have also looked at this from the user side. There's one survey that asked users what happens when they have to frequently change their passwords, and they said, well, we create weaker passwords. A survey that we did at Carnegie Mellon, we actually surveyed users right after they'd changed their passwords, and the users who reported being very annoyed at having to change their password also had measurably weaker passwords that they just created. So I'm not the only one saying this. In the UK, the government security organization has issued a white paper that has very similar information in it. NIST is in the process of issuing new guidelines for authentication, and in particular, they have one on passwords, and they're also recommending against mandatory password expiry on a regular basis. So what can we do instead? I don't really have time to talk about it here, but I just wanted to put on your radar that there's some work going on by my students and colleagues at Carnegie Mellon on trying to, instead of telling people, make a password and keep changing it, instead, we say, make a really good password to begin with that you can remember, and offering people a password meter that actually helps them in this process using data from our research studies. So that's something in progress, and we're expecting to do an open source release of that fairly soon so that people can go and incorporate it into their websites. Okay, switching gears again, the next vignette I want to mention is mobile phone hijacking. So I was on the phone last winter, checking my voicemail, listening to my daughter's long rambling message, when all of a sudden my phone went dead. And I, you know, I walked around, I assumed, you know, bad coverage, couldn't get it to work, finally had to go find a landline phone, call back again, went to bed, next morning, woke up, and my phone still doesn't work. And then my husband emails me and says, hey, I just noticed my phone's not working. Well, that was interesting. So I called my carrier and I said, you know, we've been paying our bills, why did you turn off our phones? And they said, oh, are those your new iPhones that are not working? And I said, no, we have old Android phones. We don't have new iPhones. And they said, huh, our computer system thinks you have new iPhones. So they said, you'll have to go to a phone store and get new SIM cards. So we went to the phone store, and they looked at it, and they said, oh, there's been fraud on your account. Somebody went to, and they told us it was an Apple store, although that turned out to be wrong. But somebody went to an Apple store and showed a fake ID claiming to be you and walked out with two brand new iPhones, and they charged it to your account, and they took your phone numbers. And I didn't know such a thing was possible. I was amazed. So I called the fraud department, and they eventually, many phone calls, several trips to the phone store, eventually cleared it up. We got our phones working again. We got the charges removed from our account. It was kind of a pain. I really wanted to know how this happened and how there was somebody walking around with a fake ID with my name on it, and what else were they going to do? The phone company was actually not very forthcoming, but I did eventually find out that somebody did this in a phone store in Ohio, so not anywhere that I'd actually been anytime recently, and that apparently they showed a fake driver's license that the clerk in the store authenticated in some way. But that was really the only authentication that the phone store did. So I went to identitytheft.gov, which is run by the FTC, and I filed an identity theft complaint there. It's actually a great website. It has all sorts of good information about what to do if you're the victim of any kind of identity theft, not this kind. It has a whole step-by-step process. Given that I'm interested in usability, as I went through it, I took notes on all the problems with it, and then I emailed the people in charge my suggestions. Yeah, I don't really think they liked hearing from me, but but nonetheless, they have actually implemented a few of the changes I suggested. From the identitytheft.gov website, it has links directly to the credit agencies. You can file fraud reports. You can also submit information which will go into the FTC's database as we're tracking identity theft, and you can then print out an affidavit about what happened, which you can take to your local police station, which I did, and file a crime report with your law enforcement agency. And this is important to have that on record of your identity theft as you deal with the credit agencies. I posted on Facebook to my friends that this had happened, and one of my friends, who's somebody that some of you may also know, the same thing happened to her the same week. And I thought, wow, you know, it's not just me. I'd never heard of this, and now I have a close friend who this also happened to. And then I started talking around to other people, and actually, I know a whole bunch of people that this has happened to. And so then I started wondering, well, how common is this? And how come I didn't know about it? So I started looking for news articles, and there wasn't much in the national news, but in local news, especially local TV news, lots of stories about this happening for all the major phone carriers where people were complaining about this happening. Also, people getting arrested for being the identity thieves in this case, and you know, some of these people who were arrested have been arrested multiple times in different states for basically doing the same thing over and over again. When I looked at the international news, it was even scarier. So these domestic attacks that I've been showing you, these are cases where the thieves seem to want the cell phones and then they go and sell them. Internationally, it seems it's really common that people do this because they want the phone number and they get somebody's bank account number, they get access to their phone, they go and transfer money out of people's bank accounts, and then when there is a text message sent as part of two-factor authentication, they can respond to it because they have their phone number and they're able to drain people's bank accounts. This is apparently a big problem overseas. So given that I was working at the FTC, I said, well, let me find out how often people are reporting this to the FTC. And so I got access to our Consumer Sentinel Network, which is where all this data goes, and started searching to see examples of these types of reports. And it was really scary reading these reports and going, wow, that's exactly what happened to me, and it's happening to all of these other people. So we don't know too much about our sample. We know that a very small fraction of people who are identity theft victims actually report things to the FTC. We think it's around 1 or 2%. So when we see these incidents, they should be multiplied by a number that's probably like two orders of magnitude. But what we saw in January 2013 was about 1,000 people reported these sorts of incidents to the FTC. And this was about 3% of all of the identity theft reported to the FTC. 3 years later, the number is now 2,600, and that's about 6% of the identity theft incidents reported to the FTC. So this appears to be a growing problem. I contacted all of the major phone carriers, and I asked them about it. They wouldn't give me any numbers, but they all said that there were some things they were doing to help consumers. And basically, it's allowing consumers to set a password or a passcode on their account so that if anybody wants to make changes to your account, they have to know that password in order to do that. So if I had had that password on my account, in theory, somebody walking into that phone store would have had to provide it before they would have given them a new phone. It's not clear how well this works, or it doesn't appear to be foolproof, but it does seem to be better than nothing and something that I would encourage people to look into doing. So once I had gathered all this information, I thought it was important to share it, and so I wrote another blog post, again on the front page of the FTC website, got a lot of attention. I was put in a lot of media. I actually got to go onto the Today Show and talk about this, which was really exciting. I also learned that shortly after this happened to me, Duray McKesson, who is a very prominent activist, a Black Lives Matter activist, he has about 400,000 Twitter followers. Somebody took over his Verizon account for the purpose of using two-factor to get into his Twitter account, and they wanted to tweet as him. Okay, last thing I want to talk about today is how you can help the FTC protect consumers. So the FTC has a lot of events related to technology, and we try to get technology experts involved in our events. We've had a whole series this fall, but coming up for over the next few months, we have a smart TV workshop in December where we're going to be talking about security and privacy issues related to smart TVs. And then on January 12th, we have PrivacyCon. This is our second annual one-day privacy conference, and we will have probably about 20 papers being presented, posters. Should be a great event in Washington, D.C. All of our events, though, are live streamed over the web, so even if you can't make it to D.C., you can participate remotely. And we also publish archives of all the videos on the website. As you see these sorts of events, if you have something to contribute, definitely consider sending in a proposal to participate. We're also very interested in seeing your research papers, not just when we have a workshop, but anytime you have something that's going to be relevant to our consumer protection mission. And we've set up research at ftc.gov. You can send us your completed papers or your thoughts about work in progress or your thoughts about research you're thinking about doing that you would like to tell us about. And I want to give you just a few examples of some of the areas where we're particularly interested in hearing from security and privacy researchers. We're very interested in looking at ways that we can assess risks posed by breaches and vulnerabilities. This is very useful when there's investigations and cases against companies to being able to quantify some of this. We're also very interested in anything that can be done to help protect consumers from ransomware, malvertising, anything along those lines. We're interested in being able to, again, in the context of an investigation, tie exposed data back to a specific breach. And we're interested in research that helps connect those dots. We're also interested in any research that can help us spot fraud. And this is a variety of different types of fraud that we hear about, whether it's people posting fake ads on Craigslist or people posting fake ads, display ads on websites or phone scams, telemarketers, any kind of fraud. IoT devices, big issue, and based on the news in the past few weeks, has become an even bigger issue. So we're interested in research on how to better secure IoT devices and platforms. We're interested in defensive measures that can isolate an IoT device so that it doesn't infect the rest of your network. And we're also interested in helping consumers. So, a question that I get is, consumers say, well, I have some smart devices in my house. How do I know whether they are part of that botnet that was part of that attack last week? What would I do? I look at it. It looks like it always looks. How do I know whether it's infected? We want tools that can help consumers. Speaking of tools, there are lots of tools that actually we're interested in seeing, and we're interested in research about tools and techniques. So any sort of tools that will help consumers protect their privacy. We're interested in tools that will help consumers understand where their data is going. We're interested in tools for investigators that that can help us understand the practices associated with third-party libraries and apps. We're interested in tools that help us identify tracking and cross-device tracking. And then finally, we're also interested in tools that will help us understand discriminatory algorithms. So I will end it there, and I'd be happy to talk with you all during the break more about any of these topics. Thank you.